We're trying to do this morning, Sunday morning. Today is whatever today is, June 28th, 2015. And God willing, if things go well and I'm able to put together a class for every week or every other week, then that's what we're going to do. Before we begin the class, I'd like to preface with a question. When you think of our rabbis today, okay, and I'm talking about our current day rabbis, what do you think of? What do you think of anybody?
Is that on?
It's on. Yeah, it's on.
No, you don't have to say your name before you say
they don't have to say your name. That's why nobody sees your face.
They know my voice.
No, seriously, what do you think of? Do you think of old times, Sephardi Hachamim? Or do you think of these Ashkenazi wannabes? Or do you think of these modern YU types who are confused and don't know where they fit into the world?
Depends
what do
on
you
the
think
rabbi.
Of?
The second two.
Depends on who you're talking about.
You got a little bit of both.
You got a little bit of both. I don't think there's any fear today of the rabbis. I think while we were growing up, I think there was more of a...
Right, but that's our view of the rabbi. But what about the rabbi himself? How do you think he views himself in today's world? What is his job? What is he here to do?
Are you talking about pulpit rabbi or just the...
We don't have much more than pulpit rabbis today. Unless guys that are sitting in Kulei all day. We don't have true hachamim that are, you know... They study Torah, you know, and they teach Torah, but they also go to work on a regular basis. We don't really have those.
Everyday personal lives.
Okay.
You
know. So then we're going to look now. Now that we laid this question and it's rolling around in your head and you're trying to figure out where's Joey going with this, okay? We're going to think about the Hachamim of the city of Tiberias. And we're talking about approximately 1930. Okay? So we're putting ourselves back 85 years ago. It's not that long ago. 18 years before the establishment of the State of Israel. Already the yeshuv is building up, people are making aliyah, but the Sephardim still have a very, very strong presence throughout the Eretz Israel. Okay, as far as religion and Torah is concerned, they are the majority, especially in a city like Tiberias.
Mekubalim. A lot of Mekubalim were there.
A lot of Mekubalim in every city, though. Tiberias, at the time, had a very small population. Approximately 8,000 people, and 6,000 of them were Jews, and from those Jews, the majority were Sephardim. So, we had two important personalities we're going to be dealing with. Rabbi Yaakov Hai Zirihan, who was chief rabbi of Tiberias until he passed away in 1953, and his successor, Rabbi Meir Waqnin, who took over in 1953 till he passed away in 1975. We've dealt with Rabbi Meir Waqnin in the past. Rabbi Meir Waqnin, as some of us may know, was the default, quote-unquote, chief rabbi of our community here on the Lower East Side. He left Tiberias to come collect funds in 1914. He arrived at the shores of Manhattan. Not much later, World War I broke out. He was stuck here. The community was obviously a very small community, but it was hungry for Torah.
Well, that's who he became chief rabbi of this community?
He became chief rabbi of this community.
That's why you asked me who was the first chief rabbi. Remember, I asked Motel?
Yeah.
He told me who it was. I thought you'd say Rabbi Kass.
No. So he never accepted the title, but he was considered chief rabbi. So Rabbi Waqnin was chief rabbi until approximately 1919, till he was able to get on a boat back to Eretz Israel in 1920. Now, you have to understand, the community, the leaders pestered him. They bothered him to no end. They wanted him to stay here, to move his family, to do whatever he can do. They wanted him here forever. He would not give up on Eretz Israel. He said, "Stop asking me. Enough's enough." He asked me week after week, month after month, year after year, I am going back as soon as I can, and he went back. But he really helped to shape and form the community in many great ways. We're not going to get into all that right now. Okay, just realize that in his book, Vayomen Meir, which he published in 1939, besides his regular introduction to the book, he put in a second introduction just to talk about the SY community of New York. Okay, it's an amazing introduction. It gives you a glimpse of the history of what was going on over here, how he felt about the community, how the community felt about him, the amount of Torah Mitzvot going on. Now, so we're dealing with a real old world Sephardi Hacham.
Do we have any pictures of?
We have a picture. I don't have a picture with me, but very easy. You can pull one up on the internet.
I say Juga.
Juga, Ken. The Hidga Gil. All right, so we're going to look at now a teshoubah from Vayomim Meir. Take one pass around, please. Yeah, you're going to tell me what's all these, you know, how many pages we have here? 14 pages. How are we going to do 14 pages in an hour? It's impossible.
Not on Wednesdays.
On Wednesday we can't do 14 pages. And then we're sitting there for 3 hours. Yeah. So.
Falling asleep.
Ezra. No.
Moshe, right? Moshe, right?
Not Moshe, Meir.
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 With a thof, right? Waqnin.
Two verbs. Aleph, Ayin, Kof, Nun, Yud, Nun.
It must be related to the Waqnin that was in Barkai.
Not necessarily, no.
Waqnin in Barkai, a couple of
no, probably not.
In
any case.
He was accepted amongst all the Sfaradim in Brooklyn at that time, all the S.Y.s.
Yes,
he was the guy.
He was the guy. There was nobody that had any contentions or any problems or any issues with him whatsoever. He was a tremendous old world Sephardi Talmid Chacham, and he was accepted not only here, but he was accepted in Israel, obviously within his traditional world, and later on as well after the establishment of the state, he still became chief rabbi, and he was chief rabbi from 53 till 75, and Chachamim from throughout the country would always travel to Tiberias to visit him and to consult with him. Passed away in 75. By the way, he's the father-in-law of Rabbi David Shalush. Okay? So, in 1930, watch this, guys. Look at page 1 before we start reading. In 1930, the Munkacher Rebbe, okay, you know, among the Hasidim, among the Ashkenazim, there are many different groups. Okay, sects, groups, really, they're from different cities. And each city claims that they have it right. Okay? Not much unlike us. I'm Halabi, I'm Shami, I'm Egyptian, I'm Lebanese, I'm Ian Baghdadi. You know, it's not much different, but among them, they have their Rebbe. And their Rebbe for them is everything. So they had a big Hasid, the Munkacher Rebbe. Okay? And his name was Rabbi Chaim Elazar Shapira. And this Rebbe said, you know what, I need to get to Israel. No matter what it takes, I need to get there for one reason only. I need to visit the Sabah Kaddisha. The Sabah Kaddisha was a big Sephardi Chacham. He was a big Mikubal. He was a big Hasid. His name was Rabbi Shlomo El-Azar, or Shlomo El-Azar Al-Fandari. Rabbi Shlomo Eliezer Al-Fandari was born in 1820 in Turkey, in Istanbul. Okay, and he didn't die until 1930 in Israel. So basically, 110 years. Wow. Yes.
Seriously?
Seriously, 110 years old. Okay, so he was born in Istanbul. He held rabbinical positions in Istanbul. In fact, he became the Hakam Bashi over there. In 1897, he was appointed as chief rabbi of Damascus. Keep that in mind. 1897, he was chief rabbi of Damascus. In 1904, he left. He moved to Haifa. Okay, and he stayed in Haifa till about 1918. From there, he moved to Tiberias. And then, as his health was failing, around 1925, he moved to Yerushalayim. And he passed away in 1930. So, this Rabbi Shapira, the Munkacher Rebbe, was able to make this trip to Palestine at the time. He got to Yerushalayim, and he basically saw and hung out with Rabbi Al-Fandari for 13 days, close to the end of his life. And then after that, he moved back. Rabbi Shapira went back to his hometown of Munkacher. He was together with his little entourage. He had Rabbi Moshe Goldman with him, who was his secretary. And when they got back to Munkach, Rabbi Goldman put together the 13-day diary of Rabbi Shapira. He put it together and published it. This published work, called Masa'ot Yerushalayim, is what bothered Rabbi Waqnin. Now we'll look at the teshuvah. So the second paragraph on the bottom of the first column. Bema Amar. Okay? Siman Yom Sheni Dalet Kav Gimel Kav Bezel. Rabbeinu Sipir. Ahar kach tahad ahad asihin lahasaba kaddisha bibirkat asay bisamim shebarich mafsik bin poripriya gifin lehashik kaddish yedin in batin. Mishalon yirei lo haminhag vada'a zo והשיב הסבא קדישה כן הסדק איתו בהיותו רב בדמשק ביטל מנהג זה וכולי עיין שם. So the Munkach Rabbi got to Eretz Israel, big Hasid, people invited him, well, we have a Brit Milah today, Faddal Rabbi, come to the Brit Milah. He saw after Birkat HaGefen they're making Birkat Besamim like we still do today. It bothered him, he didn't like it. In his meetings with the Sabah Kaddisha, Rabbi Al-Fandari, he discussed it with Rabbi Al-Fandari. Rabbi Al-Fandari told him, you're absolutely correct. It bothers me as well. And when I was chief rabbi in Damascus, I annihilated this custom. I stopped it. After the Birkat HaGefen, said no more Besamim, we went straight to Asher Kaddisha in the Batin. And he left it at that.
What's problematic?
You could go look over there, but he doesn't say what. Okay, this Mas'ot Yerushalayim, he tells, he basically looks at it as a hifsik. More than anything else, he looks at it as a hifsik. How can you go from HaGefen, and now you're breaking off with this Beracha B'Samim for no reason whatsoever in his eyes? Remember, the Ashkenazim do not do B'Samim, so he saw it as strange and odd and as a hifsik. And then to go to Asher Kaddish Yedid. The Rabbi Al-Fandari that we're talking about, the Sabah Kaddisha, he was called Sabah Kaddisha, the holy old grandfather, because he was a Hasid. He was very different than your typical Sephardi Hakam, because he was very extreme in his views. He was very, very stringent in everything he did. If you read his teshuvot, you wouldn't believe this was a Sephardi Hakam that's writing them. He looks like the most mahmir of mahmir guys that could walk out of Me'ah Sha'arim. No, I don't mean it in a derogatory way at all. He was a great man, great posik. You see, if you read his teshuvot, you see his mind. You see, it's involved in Torah 24/7. But he felt that the only way to be is to be as close to God as possible is by removing yourself as much as possible from the real world. Yes, to a certain degree. So here goes Rabbi Waqnin. Ube'emet. קשה לשמוע דבר זה שיעשה מפי המלכות מן מלכי מרנה ורבנה לבטל מנהג שנהגו בו כל תפוצות הגולה כהקדוש ספרדים ישמריהם סורם וגואלם. Rabbi Waqnin is saying this is really impossible. How could we sit here and listen that such things came out of the holy mouth of the rabbi of rabbis, in other words the Rabbi Al-Fandari, to annul a custom that is done by all Sephardi communities? How could it be? Mekelim kadmeta, it's an old custom. Like I'll explain. So he's quoting different sources already, but it's not important what he's quoting. He's basically quoting from the Sidi Hamid, Bihiskiya Medini, who was rabbi in Hebron, and for Bihayim Palachi, who was rabbi in Izmir, Turkey. Ibn Minhag Tamuwa Vizar, he's quoting his Hachamim is saying what? If you find a Minhag that is odd, that is strange, Yesh Lanu Lamed Zechud Ul Bakesh Kol Tasdiqi Al Masam Al Minhagahu. Do not just wave it away. You have to find a way to justify the minhag. If there is a minhag, it means it was established and it was done in the presence of Hachamim, and obviously they had a reason for it, and it's not up to you to say, this minhag's stupid, forget about it. You have to find a way to justify and upkeep the minhag. kisharau is minhag al shetimhon. And this is what all our previous hachavim did whenever they witnessed any sort of strange minhag. Even if the minhag seems like it goes against the deen, against the halakha, keep searching. You will find a reason for it, and a reason that fits into the halakha. Ki minhag mibatel halakha, because a minhag can even annul a halakha.
You believe that?
He's saying we believe it.
He's quoting you a source here, but I don't know.
He believes it. Mm-hmm. He believes it, and he's telling you that all the hachamim, all that he said right here, at the bottom of page 1, v'cho asu kadmonenu kishalau ez minhag shel timahon. This is the manner and the way with all our previous hachamim dealt with things when it comes to minhag. Minhag ta'ud is minhag ta'ud. They'll deal with that. Minhag ta'ud is usually dealt with immediately during that generation. It's not left. Minhag ta'ud is generally not left to keep, you know, building and going on.
Look, in the Syrian community, let's use modern examples.
Go ahead, please.
Of minhagim that somehow came in that don't really have a makor.
Please, let's hear it.
Good example, perhaps, raffle off coins at Pidyon HaBen.
Right.
No real.
Raffling off coins at Pidyon HaBen is a custom that was established by Rabbi Sion Maslaton alav shalom. He was the Kohen for most Pidyon HaBen because he was a Kohen and he's a rabbi, so people invited him to be the Kohen. After 1, 2, 3, 4 Pidyon, how many coins is he eating anymore? He said, you know what? I want to establish, and he said it in public, he said, I want to establish something so we could raise money for charities. Different charities. If the people are willing, let's do it. And the people said it's a wonderful idea. That's very nice of you. You don't want the money. You don't want to keep the coins for yourself. And you're finding a way to raise tzedakah. And they went along with it. What's the problem? No problem with that. Everybody agrees there's no problem with that. So it's not a minhag ta'ut. It's a minhag that he established, that he asked the people about. The people accepted. And it doesn't go against any halakha whatsoever. Correct?
What about a minhag that goes against the halakha?
Such as?
Keying the bread.
I'm sorry?
Keying the bread.
Keying the bread is not our minhag. It's not our minhag, period. It's not our minhag either. You missed those classes.
I see a lot of people do it.
So we'll get you the recordings of that class.
It is someone's minhag.
Right now we're dealing with our minhagim, and as far as turning, we could find sources for.
What about the minhag of not learning on Xmas?
That is minhag of the Ashkenazim,
right.
And the problem is they do not, unfortunately, many people today do not know why they stopped learning. Okay, bottom line is very simple. On that night, it was very dangerous for them to be outside in the Beit Midrash. You had the Christians go out to midnight mass, and they would go out to, thank you. They would go out to midnight mass, and what would happen is that they get in their mood because they're dealing with their God, okay, and then they're thinking about how he was born and how he died and how he's rebrought, and so they get in this mode of very anti-Jewish. If they're passing by a Beit Midrash or a kinis, and there's people, the Jews, and they're learning, well, you know what's going to happen. So it became dangerous. So this is not a minhag that it's asur to learn, but out of danger. Okay? Any time you have an issue of sakana, the hachamim have told you have to keep your way out of sakana. You have to protect your lives. It's very simple. So you have to find a way to justify the minhag or find the source of the minhag. You cannot just whisk it away.
One more.
Go ahead.
One more. Last one.
Why not?
What about we have a minhag that people often quote from the Zohar not to study Mikra at night?
Okay.
Would you say that's a legitimate minhag?
It's a legitimate minhag for people who can study something else. If you ask a Mikubal, for example, okay, and you're an Am Ha'aretz, you're a simple person. Okay, you can translate Am Ha'aretz in many ways. So I'm going to say you're a simple person. You do not know how to study anything else but Mikra. it's your only chance to, let's say, read the parasha or to read some Tehillim. You're up early in the morning, you're working all day, you don't have time otherwise, and you don't have the knowledge to study Torah Sheva Al Peh. Okay, you only know how to read Torah Sheva Bichtav. What's he going to tell you? He's going to tell you, of course, do it, because you're not at that level. So we're okay. Again.
If a person is at that level, but he needs to do some looking to some parasha thing or something, he's not really reading.
So he's looking. From what I've read into, they don't consider. If you're looking up Pirushim on the Humash and things like that, they don't consider that Limud Torah Shebichtav. Limud Torah Shebichtav. They're really looking at it as reading Mikra, straight reading of Mikra.
Let's say practicing to read the Torah next morning.
So that, again, that's not a problem. Again, it's practice, not Limud. This line of Limud is a very, very fine line. I'm sure they would. I'm sure, absolutely. But Mary was asking about Al Pi HaZohar. That's how I was bringing up the Mikubalim.
Joey, I know we could go on forever with all these minhagim.
Yeah, we can. Especially with me.
And I know we spent about 3 weeks, if I'm not mistaken, on this particular minhag of not going to your father's funeral. A boy, not going to his
father's funeral. Right, we dealt with that.
That's a minhag.
That's a minhag according to a certain understanding of the Zohar. Okay?
But doesn't it go against the obligation that a son needs to bury his father?
Does it go against it?
Seems to. You're letting other
where is that? Is there an obligation? Is there an obligation?
No, but it says you can.
Say it again?
It says you can.
It says you can, but is there an obligation?
In
other words, you'll say you're out of town, okay? Person is out of town, and a parent passes away. You're waiting until the person comes back to town to perform the burial? Of course not. So that means it's not obligatory upon the child. In other words, you have to find a way to masdik the minhag. That's what the Hakam is telling us over here. Okay? Let's go with that. Okay, let's accept it for what he's telling us, and see where he wants to go with it.
It sounds like minhag ta'ud is a way that you could never find a way to justify.
Minhag ta'ud you cannot justify. Minhag ta'ud is minhag ta'ud, and that's why I mentioned to, I think Murray brought up minhag ta'ud, or you brought up minhag ta'ud.
Right.
Murray brought it up. That minhag ta'ud is generally squashed, you know, while it's happening, almost immediately. Okay? It's not left.
More than one generation to realize that it's a ta'ud?
No. Minhag ta'ud means some people start doing something and the hachamim, you know, bug out and stop it.
I have like kaparot.
How about it?
Where rabbis went against it and still obviously prevalent.
Because you have sederim lekan, sederim lekan. You have both ways of looking at it.
Oh, meaning that they do have something to rely on.
They have something upon to rely on.
I mean, if we say that we accept Maran, isn't it tough to go against him? Especially on something where he felt very strongly about it.
Okay, so let's say we accept Maran, okay? So now, the biggest proponent of accepting Maran in our modern day is Chaim Avdi Yosef, alav shalom, right? Chaim Avdi Yosef didn't tell us to stop kaparot, did he?
You know more than me.
I don't know anything. I'm asking you a question. You just came back from studying for a whole year.
He didn't. He didn't tell us to stop.
He didn't tell us to stop. So, either he's upholding Maran, or he's going against Maran. Which one is it? Or maybe he sees different ways of reading Maran.
Said, does he? Maybe he took it as a pashut. This is what Maran said. It's obvious. I don't need to make another teshuvah.
But if you open up Yahweh Da'at, he has a teshuvah about kaparot.
Oh, so he allows it?
Yes. We'll discuss it. There's a lot of topics. We could bring topics up from now till forever.
Yeah.
Okay? And each one, you know, demands its own study. And it's what we've been doing for years. Correct, Ezra?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's go back to the teshuvah of Chaim Meir Waqnin. So we said, Minhag Mibatil Halakha, and that's where we stopped. ובכלל שום הבא בדבריו, הגאון בדי הכהונה, אין לבטל שום מנהג שאם יהיה כוח לבטל מנהג שנהגו אבותיהם, בעיר זו יבטלו מנהג זה, ובעיר אחרת מנהג אחר, ועל ידי זה יבטלו מנהגי ישראל שהם תורה. Okay? So, bottom line, if we start allowing people to annul minhagim, every city is going to start annulling minhagim, and each one is going to call out a ban on the next minhag, the next city and the other city, and then before you know it, all our minhagim are gone. Not much unlike what people want to do today. Verab, lo rasala batel kiriyata halle berosh chodesh, av shayyum berchin, udda'ato, hevaya beracha labattala. שעובר משום לא תישא. משום why? שכבר נהגו אבותיהם. So, the opinion on Rosh Chodesh, whether we make Hallel with Beracha or not. And the opinion of Rab was not to do it. He looked at it as a minhag, and you don't make Beracha on minhag, and he considers Beracha labattala. But since he saw that people were doing it already, and it was the minhag of their forefathers, he left it alone, because he would not annul a minhag that they were already following, even though he was against it. This is another topic by itself, and really most sources, if you really get into it, we could spend a good 6 months studying this topic of Hallel and Rosh Chodesh. It looks like it's the proper minhag to do.
In Seattle, they do Rosh Chodesh.
Yes. More outside of the immediate Middle East. Immediate Middle East meaning the minhagim of, in this case, Eretz Israel, Egypt, Syria, Lebanon, and even Iraq in this case, outside of those communities, all Sephardim say Beracha on Hallel of Rosh Chodesh. Okay, so if you're looking at the Turks, you're looking at the Greeks, you're looking at the Bulgarians, you're looking at Spanish Portuguese, etc., they all make Beracha. All the Moroccans, Tunisians, Libyans, Algerians, they all do it. You want to say something?
When I was in Turkey, I don't remember that.
So they do. Absolutely.
Yeah?
Make a phone call right now.
Maybe they changed me. I don't know. I remember I was there for Rosh Chodesh, and I knew any Beracha. You say like Likro?
Yes, Likro Tehalil.
Ashkenazim do?
Yes, like other Sephardim do too. No, I know. I'm telling you honestly.
Yeah, I mean it.
No. It's the truth. Turks do say it.
I'll make a call.
Make a call. Well, wait, go ahead.
Now? No, it's international call. I have to wait for it.
Yeah, call Rabbi Nisim. Baruch atah Adonai Elohim Melech HaOlam
Shehakol
Nehyeh
Baro. That's a good idea. I'll ask it.
Okay. וכל העין שם לזאת סלמתי אל ליבי ללקט באומרים מפי סופרים וספרים איזה גרגרים להראות שורש המנהג הקדוש הזה על מה עודנה קוטבעו ושהוא דווקא מיוסד על פי ותיקים ראשונים כמלאכים והוא עשוי לכל הדין כבכה באורדאה ואני ארשום רק מעד מן המעד פתח כוחותו של מחה והרבנים הגאונים שליבם פתוח כפתחו של עולם ימסעו כהנה וכהנה טעמים רבים שמבוססים על עיני האמה ועשה יסורים ויסור יסורים משגיעות וימין המקין ירסום וזה יחליף את הצורי בגועדי. Bottom line is telling you, I will show you the source, the roots of this minhag, and I'm only going to give you a little taste of the roots of this minhag. And those hachayim that are out there that have time and they have the knowledge, they could go and continue writing on this topic, and they will bring many, many other sources for the minhag. So obviously we're not going to go through everything he's writing about the minhag, but I'd like to read some of it. So we're going to start from Rishit Kol. Yes.
Quick question. Just to backtrack, when the Ramon Kacha Rebbe visits Hamal Fandari, does the Chacham says that he tried to uproot it, or he just says, I was against it also?
Look what he said. One more time. He said, Ubihiyoto Rab Bidamesik Bittel Minhazi. He stopped it. So, you have to think, in 1897, he was in Damascus. He was there till 1904. So, at the very least, during that window, they stopped doing it. Okay? Now, it doesn't mean there weren't those who did it when he wasn't watching, okay? Or there were other hachamim in the city that were there, old established families, okay, that they had their own synagogues and their own private brit milah, and they did it anyway. We're not going to say it stopped, because we know till today the Shamis do it. Okay, so it could be that it was stopped, and whoever took over in 1904, 1905, reinstituted, or the people said, you know, hacham, this is what was going on, we had a minhag, and so-and-so stopped it, but we want to revive it, and they revived it. Could be a lot of different sources, but we know that they definitely do it till today. But at his time period, he said he stopped it. Rashid called. קבלה היא בידינו מפום רבנה כששעה שעתם שברכים לה בסמים בית המילה מפני שידוע הדבר על פי הזור הקדוש והמדרש שאליהו זלל מוכרח להיות נוחר בכל מילה ומילה בכדי שהפה שלמד קטגוריה על ישראל ילמד סנגוריה וזה נקרא בשם מלאך הברית ולכן בעת התגלות אליהו זלל העומדים שם נשמתם מאירה ומזהירה והביא אליה כנשמה יתרה ובעת סלדוקו הביא אליהו עגמת נפש הזה מריחים בסמים להשיב לנפש כמו מוסה שבת קודש. So I tell you, at every Brit Milah, we know that Eliyahu HaNabi has to be there. This is our tradition that we have based upon the Zohar, based upon the Midrash, because he spoke bad about Am Yisrael with the Mizvah Brit Milah. He now has to be at every Brit Milah. When Eliyahu HaNabi is there, okay, obviously, he brings a certain uplifting of our neshama because he is there. And when he departs at the end of the milah, it's like Musa Shabbat when our neshama yitara is departing, and so we use it besaying to revive ourselves, like smelling salts. Figure if a person faints, same concept. So over here, the Brit Milah, we know Eliyahu Nabi is leaving, so same thing, we have besaying.
What did he say about Brit Milah?
He said, who told Borei Olam, look, your children are not keeping your berit. That's it. And Borei Olam got angry at him. How dare you speak about my people? That was it. Doesn't take much to anger Borei Olam. Borei Olam loves Am Yisrael. He doesn't want people speaking bad. Okay? Ubsefer, the back me ah. The Rabbi Meir Waqnin is a book by Rabbi Abraham Hamawi, the same author of Beit Bihira. Marech Mem Hibi Mishe Mefreshim Ta'an Besamim Beit Hamila Al Piha Midrash Rabba Sof Parashat Lech Lecha Bibi Omara Beit Yosef Beit Bibordin Biyordin'a Besof Sman Okay Benosa Ahir Okay Not Important Omara Ayy Wub Sha'a Shemal Abraham Abinu Ala Bishalom Et Yidei Beito He'amidan Gib'at Arelot Bezarha Alehim Hamma Beit Li'u ועל הריחן לפני הקדוש ברוך הוא כקטורת סמים מחעולה שהיא כלי לאשים. So when Abraham Avinu, he's the first person to do Brit Milah in our tradition, when he did Brit Milah for all members of his household, okay, and according to the tradition, he had many people he did Brit Milah to at one shot, he built a little mountain of foreskins. Okay? Yeah, it sounds strange. It's okay. He built a little mountain of foreskins, and the sun came and shone down upon it, and it gave a certain type of pleasant odor that went up to Borei Olam, like Ketoret, in a sense. I know it sounds very, very strange, but this is what he's telling us over here. And this is like the Ketoret. אמר הקדוש ברוך הוא בשעה שיהיו בעניו של זה באים לידי עבירה ולידי מעשים רעים אני נזכר להם הריח הזה ומתמלא עליהם רחמים. So when my children do עוונות, I'm going to remember this scent because I enjoyed it so much and I'm going to have mercy upon them. ומרחם עליהם ולזה מביאים בסמים בעת המילה להריח להזכיר ריח ניחוח של זכות אבות. And this is another reason we bring the besamim at the Brit Milah, so we could smell it, and then we could remember the zechut of our abot, of abot being who? The first ab, Abraham Avinu. Sefer v'yom ha'davihi, v'hirashah l'chlecha, hibi devarav harah, chumat anach, v'hirashah kitisah, v'ma harah l'megadmi zazad, kitav yad, remez, kach lecha sammim. So now he's bringing remez, the hida is bringing, kach lecha sammim, nataf, right? What's nataf? Nitifat dam hamila, the dripping of the blood of the mila. Okay. Shahalat othiyot shahulat ahaba ani. We have in Tehidi in Shir Shirim. Shahalat ahaba ani. What shahulat ahaba ani? Shahalat ani hulat hamila. So what is it you're telling us in parentheses? Mila in misfarqatan ahaba. If you take the word mila, okay, if you look at it as misfarqatan, 40. Okay, 4 plus 0 equals 4. Yod is 10. 1 plus 0 is 1. So we have 4 and 1 is 5. Lamed, 3 plus 0. Okay, we have 3. And then the hey is 5. You add it all up, equals 13. Ahaba equals 13. Shahwalat ahaba ani shahwala mila ani. Vahilbana, hayat libana. He's looking at it. Hayat libana bayyom hashimini. In other words, the eighth day of the month. Ause, Knesset Israel, Libana Mila. We are doing weird for who, not to Libana, but Libana to our children, to our son. We're doing Mila. Ulbona Zakka, Shahayulit Mitahir Bitum Ata, Akan Shono. Hare Shikor, Anyan Hamila, Ramuz Pasuka Besamim, the Ot Mufet, the Horoch, Yesh Kesh, the Ze, Mze, Fize, Kama Yumtak, the Haikh. هذا بيها دبر موشي بيردعا سمان ريس مخه مشم مهاريل زال يفيك وحسن داك مهم وهذا صندوق محزيك هيدا بالكاف هبيك كيلو كيلو بنا مزبيح في على ألف كيتور. So the sandak is even greater than the muhed because the sandak is holding it as if he has a mizbeach on his lap and he has like he's bringing the korban of the ketoret. He's telling you over here. And once again to the ketoret. V'kashe dilma dima mizva hamila rakul mizvat ha'alat ketoret. V'rak lakrabat korban ha'temid. V'chad domeda ad rabba ha'alat ha'yid arbeka sandad domey yoter v'ha'alat ha'korban ha'gabem mizviyach abad. Lifei anal, sham mizva v'amila nimez v'fasu ke simmoneh ha'ketor mukhad mizze v'habibah mizvat ha'mila lifanay v'rak shimo ke'alat ha'ketoret. Okay, so saying it could even look as if you're actually bringing a korban, but since we know Borei Olam loves the ketoret so much, that's why they're comparing it to the ketoret. V'lachen, kevan shehashubah hamila ke'alat ketoret lezot nahagu lehabia besamim be'et hamila. Once again, because we know that how much Borei Olam loves the scent of the ketoret, once again we're bringing the besamim et hamila. Zeichir atan l'reich simmaneh ketoret. شيش كيش تعمل ملا إما بسميم عن شام ولا زي يش نقول لبريق على يان لحوب يش لبسميم لحوب بتي كوز ويش نقول قام شنهم يحل كاشير باس كما رام شو حان روح يرد يعاس ما نسا من بريق على كوز بريق جيفن ويش نقول لتول داس بيدوم بريق على بريق بأمي بخشير كديش etc. So he's going through sources now which we're not going to get into. Bottom line, he's showing you it's even in the Beit Yosef the whole issue of bringing the hadas and how it's connected, and even on Yom Ta'anit, where you can't do what you call, you wouldn't be drinking wine if you're doing the Brit Milah on the Ta'anit itself, you would still be doing the Bisamim, showing you the importance of the Bisamim. שמרחין שניהם יחד והגן אפילו לחוק ועל הפעילה לגופה דחתה ולימד כבנת מרן היו יש נוגעים בתול הדס לבנן למד לקוס אלא במרחין להדס לבד ועלה במרחין השקדש כדכתו הגיינים, משמעות לשון הלבוש, אחריו, בין עובי בלכות מילה, והרב שיח ישחק, העתיק ודבר מהר"ן בזה הלשון, ברכים לכל פרי הגפן, ונוהגים לטול הדס בידו מברך במריח, ואחר כך מברך לשקדש, בדלגו תיבד ויש. יעד שהם פוסקים הלכה למעשה על הזמן הזה, וביות שכבר הכל נהגו לברך גם על הריח הזאת, דלגו תיבד ויש. So he's saying, since even though Maran and the Beit Yosef brings Vayesh, there are those that do the Besamim, when you look in the Beit Obed be Yehuda Shemuel Ashkenazi, and you look in as well to the Siyah Yishak, or be Yishak Alfiyah, they both mention this thing, but they don't say Vayesh, and there are those that have Besamim. They automatically put, after Hagefin, you go straight to Besamim, you make Beracha on Besamim, then you go to Asher Kiddush, because everybody already has this manhag of doing Besamim, everybody meaning among the Sephardim, obviously. דקו בבישמי, אני גם יודע, תראו מלשום מהר"ן, על מנהג הזה, נוכחנו לדעת שדעתם היא שמהר"ן כוונתו שיברכו על שתיהם גם יחד לפוקה, שלא נפרש כוונת מהר"ן כנזכר לאל. אלה שמברכים, בואו נפרש גפן, ברכת בשמים ואשר קדש. Okay, so we're going to stop at this point regarding this, because he's going to go on and on and on, because he's really upset that somebody wants to come and stop this minhag. And he goes on for pages. So you could take this home with you and you could study it, or we may study it another time. But we're going to jump to page 7. After he feels, you know, confident that he has proved that he has shown the Bunkacha Rebbe and his assistant, Rabbi Moshe Goldman, that they are wrong regarding Bishamim, and he disagrees completely with the Sabah Kaddisha. He continues reading this book of Mas'ot Yerushalayim, this travels of 13 days to Jerusalem, which I just found out yesterday, Art Scroll translated into English and put it out, Journey to Jerusalem. So keep that in mind if you ever decide to pick it up and see how it treats the Sephardim. This is Rabbi Meir Waqnin of Tiberias. Okay, he's still a son. One son is still there. He has a grandson there. His one son in Yerushalayim.
One son is married to my wife's cousin. My wife's cousin. Mm-hmm. Remember, Shalom, Rabbi Shalom Kohen.
Of course.
So his sister is married to one of Rabbi Meir Waqnin, one who's still alive.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't think he has it between the in the first part. He has it somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
I remember what he was saying. Elberon has the sunny in the side, some sort of point in the Kiddushin.
Interesting.
Mention that over here.
I didn't notice it when I went through it. Because he's dealing strictly with Mila, and if he's bringing more and more sources for the Mila, he's not dealing with anything else over here. But it's an interesting point. We'll look it up. So he continues in Mas'ot Yerushalayim, and he finds something else that bothers him now. Page 7. Ubsefer Mas'ot Yerushalayim haneskir le'el Dav kavvav Sipir ha'admur shelita Asher shama v'rabbo ha'kadosh Adon zikano Maran maharish mishinava Zichuto yechin alinu שהגיד כי בהיותו בארץ הקודש נתאחר לתת וו תמוז להיות בהילולת האור החיים. Okay, so this Munkacha Rabbi is saying that he heard from his holy rabbi, I'm guessing it's his grandfather, Rabbi Mishinava. Okay, they told him that when he was in Eretz Israel, he extended his trip, or he was stuck there for a little bit longer, and he was there until the 15th day of the month of Tammuz. Why? To be there for the Hilula of the Ora Hayim, Rabbi Hayim ben Attar. V'haya l'pir b'aynav al asher ha-sefaradim lo ba'u al siyon ha-kadosh ha-nizkar. And he found it astounding how the Sefaradim didn't come to the grave. Sefaradim did not come to the grave of the Ora Hayim HaKadosh on the day of his passing, on Ted Vav Tammuz. Verak rubad rubam Ashkenazim. Rather, the overwhelming majority that came there, that attended, were Ashkenazim. Vehakar, and he investigated this. Veheshibudo, and they responded to him. Biyot she'ora Hayim HaKadosh hayalo milhamut immahim. Because the Ora Hayim had fights with the Sefaradim. Sefaradim would fight with him and he would fight with them. Ki hekir b'mesham, because he saw, he was obviously, he was kadosh, and he saw on their foreheads, okay, things about them, things that weren't pleasant, and he told them, oh, you, I see your forehead, you're really like this, you know, you're a had a pe, had a lib, you're a gazlan, you're a sex maniac, you're a homosexual, you're, each person, he, you know, he told them something, and he obviously he created. upset. You think, yeah. So this is what his investigation revealed to him. And they did not realize how great his kedusha was. And therefore, not only that, even after he passed away, okay, they didn't know, they didn't understand, they walked in darkness, these tefillin, they had no idea. Look in Ashkenazim. No, but not the Ashkenazim, not them. Okay? Now you think Rabbi Meir Waqnin is upset at this point, reading this?
كاتوب بزهر لشون اشيش شالطو يدي زارين بختباب حب وراب شايو تحت لشوت ايز ربانيم لقيقيها مساد من هالسفر دعيم.
Not only that, he goes and calls Sephardim, Sefer De'im. The Sephardim went later on and they found some of his manuscripts and they went and they plagiarized, they altered some of the text. And so he called them, like they licked up the words and played with them like a bunch of frogs. So now,
they really plagiarized?
This is what he wrote in this Mas'ut Yerushalayim.
Where's the Mulkas Rebbe getting all this information from?
This he got from... This is what he said. He heard from, what do you call it? From Maran Maharish Mishinava. I can't even pronounce it. Okay? Whatever it may be, Rabbi Meir Waqnin at this point is fuming. Okay? Wouldn't you be?
I'm laughing. Yeah.
Okay. My question is, and don't answer it, based upon the first part about Bishamim, that Sephardim do it, Ashkenazim don't do it, Ashkenazim don't like it, or at least this particular Ashkenazi rabbi found it problematic, and now an issue with visiting graves and belittling Sephardim. Think about the first question we opened it with. What do you think of when you think of today's rabbis? Okay? Most of them would probably maybe go along with these Ashkenazi rabbis because for some reason they don't have
the backbone.
Not that they don't have backbone. They don't have pride in their Sephardic heritage.
Right.
They don't know enough about it. Yeah. And that's what we see many times. We see foreign customs creeping into our community and many of our time-honored customs being thrown out because there is a movement to change things because we're not good enough. At least that's something that I've noticed.
Inferiority complex.
Could be. Definitely well could be.
But that sounds like something that could have been in Israel over the last 60 years, not necessarily something...
I'm not saying it's only started here. No. This is going on all over the place.
You know, it's interesting that the bigotry of the Ashkenazim, which, you know, we clearly know that they had in religious areas, translated, you know, to what Jack is saying, in the non-religious fields, even if Ashkenazim weren't Shomrei Mitzvot, they still retain their hatred towards Sephardim in other areas.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah,
that's
for sure.
Yeah, it's very unfortunate, especially in Israel.
Especially in the religious realm.
I don't know where it started.
I think it was a cultural...
No, I think...
I think they just looked down upon Sephardim. They saw Sephardim like
yeah.
Abid.
Yeah, they didn't want the back...
For sure.
They thought the socialist government...
We weren't progressive enough.
Yes.
You know, look, if you went to Lithuania or Poland, let's say the beginning of the 20th century, I think you would have found them more backwards than what people would have.
Don't know. But that's something we're here to discuss right now. I just want to leave that as a little bit of thought. Okay, so now let's look. Wait. Share dehu me'arayhu le'otan anashim shenatnu ta'am lefgam ve'yahpe'u debarim migunim be'osa'at lashon hara v'dibba' על עם השם הישרים והתמיים כלכדות ספרדים משמרים סורם בגועלם השם מעולם נועד למחשבת פיגוד בבם חדידה וחס כלפי מאורן של ישראל ראש כה בני הגולה מרן הקדוש אור החיים מן עטר. Bottom line is, how dare you? How dare you? Who are these people that come and open their mouth and speak in a disgusting manner? And they saying things, Lashon Hara, okay, but not just Lashon Hara, disgusting, inferior Lashon Hara. It's like curses. And they're talking about, I'm Hashem. These are God's people. Straight people. Simple people. These are the holy Sephardic congregations. What are you talking about? That they never, ever had a negative thought regarding the great Rabbi Chaim ben Attar. How could you say that? Asher Shemua Kadosh Mehulal Umfuar Bifihim. That his holy name is something that always rolls off their tongues with honor. Ubifrat Bedoro, and especially during his own generation. Yadua Kamman Nisim and Iflaoshina Asu Biro Irtihila Sadi Yahil Ali Elohim. And it's known how many great miracles were done in his own hometown by him in Sali, Morocco. And from his speeches that he would give daily to his holy congregation. And it wasn't just, okay, you come to first minyan and the rabbi's there is going to speak for 2 minutes. Afterwards, you had men, women, and children would come daily to listen to his words. And even more so after he made aliyah to Yerushalayim. Like the Hida gave testimony, and the Hida obviously was Sephardi. Okay, it's not only the Hida is the only person who recognized the greatness of the Ora Hayim, all the rabbis that learned with him recognized it. And the entire congregation, they all recognized him. They knew he was a holy man of God. They would exalt his name. They would lift it up. They would, you know, glorify it. Who would dare to come out against him? We never heard such a thing. He never had a milhama, not in Sephardim, not with anybody else. And why don't we go to his grave, okay, on his day? It's not because we don't recognize his greatness. Because who doesn't recognize his greatness? What's the reason? It's very simple. Our brothers, the Ashkenazim, the holy congregations of the Hasidim. Okay, so now he's telling you, it's a Hasid custom, he's going to start telling you now. This is something that the Baal Shem Tov started. Something that did not exist before, not among the Ashkenazim, not among Sephardim. But something that the Baal Shem Tov started for the Hasidim. Okay? This is his shitta, his path, and he implanted it in their hearts. He implanted this Hasidut in them. And they're traveling to each and more, from city to city, and from neighborhood to neighborhood, from province to province, from country to country, with Hagilubikach, and they got used to this. They go to every Saddiq, anybody who could consider a Sikh, they go to his grave on his day. This is not something of the Sephardim. Never, ever saw such a practice. And they definitely never left their homes to do this. And all our great hachamim, the Saddiqim, the Hasidim, the Rabbanim, everybody, they followed a different path, not this path. What do you want to say?
What exactly is it that they do?
Visiting graves.
Every year they visit the grave on the outside?
Yeah.
They go grave just for fun if they
don't. We don't do this.
Right, okay.
Okay? But what? We don't do. He's telling Hachamir Waqnin.
No.
Okay? Son of Hachamim of Hachamim. He traces his lineage back. Just, I didn't mention this before. All the way back to Rabbi Yosef ibn Waqnin. The person that Harambam wrote Moreh HaNebuchim for. Okay? This is not a slouch. This is a great hacham from a complete lineage of hachamim for hundreds and hundreds of years.
Nowadays you see a lot of Sephardim do this.
Nowadays you see Sephardim do a lot of things. Like we just said, the Sephardim have trashed everything.
So here's my question. Let's say you go down five generations from now, so 100 years, and you have this custom of visiting graves. The Sephardim now becomes more widespread.
And that's why we have teshoubah like this, and we have to cherish them.
But what I'm saying is, if it's a minhag that, let's say, establishes itself, right, and rabbis don't speak out against it.
The rabbis are not speaking out against it because they see everything that is done by others as being kadosh v'tahor, and everything that we do as being stupid and idiotic.
Okay, but what I'm saying is after five generations, right, if it becomes a minhag that's established, so now to say, okay, we won't do this minhag anymore, it's like doing exactly what he says we shouldn't
and
do.
And that's why we have the class now, to stop it.
Stop what?
To stop minhag ta'ut. This is your minhag ta'ut.
This type of thinking. This type of custom,
how did it penetrate the closed Sephardic communities of Morocco, Tunisia, and so on?
Very simple. Let me tell you.
In Morocco, they used to go to...
They used to venerate many graves in Morocco. So, the Moroccans, first of all, every Jew in every country picks up customs of the host environment, okay? So, the Muslims in general do venerate saints. But it seems that in Morocco, more than in other Muslim countries, they venerate saints even more so. And so, obviously, the Jewish communities of Morocco picked up upon that. So that already started to a certain degree. With the influx of Hasidim started coming to Morocco around 1920. Okay? That brought a lot more of it with them. Because once the Hasidim started coming in, and really by 1940, the Hasidim were a very strong presence in Morocco. A lot of them got there because they were running away from Europe, but a lot of them got there because they saw this as an opportunity to go and teach our backward brothers. And Ashkenazim got there, but Hasidim even more. And so they played this up much more. And obviously it took hold. Why not? You know? And unfortunately, you have the gravekeepers, okay, and they were, like you have a shamash in the Bet Knesset, is always looking away to pocket some extra money for himself, you know. Same thing, you always had a shamash for the Bet HaKibaroth, for Bet HaHayim. And if we get more people in, there's more money coming in, more donations for me. So he played it up as well. Hey, Mark.
Is he not going to the graves of Sephardim at all, or just on the north side? Traveling from place to place.
We didn't finish it. We did not finish it. Okay? And we didn't get to the next teshuvah. I don't know if we're going to get to it at all, but let's try.
It's a quick question. The word yortzeit, is that a Sephardic word?
No, absolutely not. He used it because he's talking to them. He's talking to them. Yortzeit is an Ashkenazi word. It means time of year.
Do we have a word?
Yor is year. Sight is time. What in time?
Do we have a word for that, or we just had a...
We have Yom Petira, you have Yom Nahala. In Arabic, it's called Ma'ad. Ma'ad means time, okay? And it's known and understood as that. Rabbi Yosef Hayim was very, very tight with Ashkenazi things. He loved Ashkenazi things, especially Hasidim, especially their writings and their styles, more than any other Sephardim from... You know, that time period.
I know a lot of people do use the word yortzeit.
Most.
Because they don't know what else you
got. Not that I recall, but I
have no idea. I would have no idea what to use.
Ma'ad. Ma'ad is the word I grew up.
Right. Zeit is German for time.
Right. So it's yortzeit.
Yortzeit.
That's what I'm telling you.
I never thought of it.
That's what yortzeit is. Time of year.
He said ma'ad.
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 Meme. Yod, Ayin, Aleph, Dalet.
But visiting—it sounds like visiting a grave of a parent that had passed. To me, seems like something not that you're going to pick up on a minhag or someone else.
We're not talking about a parent now. We're not talking about the parent. We're talking about what somebody hit the term grave hopping. Okay. Okay. In other words, you go to Israel. Oh, which graves did you go to? I just came back from Israel. I didn't go to graves. How did you not go to graves? I go, what am I going to graves for?
It's good luck.
It's a living country. What am I? I want to go to a cemetery. I go to Ocean Park. I go next door to Buster's house. I can go. I can enjoy myself.
So we've diagnosed a larger issue here, which is basically that the Ashkenazim are less, not giving us any legitimacy, or giving less legitimacy.
Well, I wouldn't say all of them. We don't stand up for ourselves is more of the problem. That's more of the problem. Because you cannot generalize and say all the Ashkenazim are doing this, because that would be wrong and not fair.
Yeah.
Okay, then we'd be no better than them.
When you have, right, correct. So but when you look at two people, one condemns the other one and the other says nothing, then you're going to say, well, he's saying something different. He's not saying anything. Looks like the guy saying something has
right.
more,
right.
Exactly.
Okay, when you are silent, it's like acceptance. But that's why Rabbi Meir Waqnin is not silent. He read the book, he didn't like it, he's writing about it. Okay?
How many times are we silent because we don't want to bother? But really, we should.
We have to bother.
He
sent it to Goldman, and Goldman responded, but we didn't get to that. We didn't get to Rabbi Zidihan yet. Let's finish this quickly. Maybe we'll continue this next week then, or the week after. We'll see. שלושת דקים וחסידים על יום לא כל השרדים מהעולם לא ראו שיטה כזו ולא נשאו ממקומם וכל רבותיהם גאוני צדיקי עולם מפורסמים בקדושתם וחסידותם הלכו במשטר בסדר אחר ולא הנהיגום בשיטה זו ולא היה להם כמרן הבעל שם טוב שיחנכם בשיטה הזאת ספרים never had anybody like the בעל שם טוב to teach them such a thing לא היו נופלים מאחינו האשכנזים but if we had a בעל שם טוב and he would have established this custom for us then we would be no different than the אשכנזים והלו מרן הארי זל הקדוש שהיה רק עם הספרדים now the ארי as we know the ארי okay mm-hmm. בישחק לוריה אשכנזי okay he from his father's side לוריה family he was אשכנזי from his mother's side he was ספרדי from משפחת פרנסיס and he was living among the ספרדים whether he lived in Israel or in Egypt or back in Israel he was living with ספרדים לא הנהיגם בסדר זה now the ארי who was the king of all Kabbalah, okay, all Hasidut, he did not teach us a custom to the Sephardim, and he was living among the Sephardim. Velazot enam holchim neshum yorsait. And because of this, they do not go to any such graves on the day of the Hilula. Lo leha Ari, velo le Maran, velo le Harambam. We don't go to the Ari, we don't go to Biyosef Karo, we don't go to Rabbi Moshe Bar Maimon. Ve'afilu le Rashbi. Even to Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Zichuto Yagin Alun Amin, Me'at Himma Sheolchim LeMeron. Very, very few people go to Meron. VeHilulato for his Hilula, VeHasiba Ahat, and one reason only. Why? Shehabot Lo Nedragilu, because it wasn't something that their fathers did. We follow our fathers. We follow tradition. We have respect for our past. וממילא הבנים לא נחנכו בזה, and therefore the children were not educated in such a manner. ואם חלילה נאמר, and if, God forbid we say, שקהל קדוש הספרדים היה להם מחלוקת עם הרשב"י, are we going to say the Sephardim had a fight with Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai? They had waged a war with him? והארי זל, והבית יוסף, וכל הצדיקים אלו דברים שלא ניתנו להיאמר. This is something that nobody would dare say. They called שכן להדפיסם, and then you printed them? Will have some but a beam and you distributed it, you know, to the masses? Velo od illa shelon it karera da ato shahara misadera kuntrus achikara ota be maamar ish hayot me the keke ham misad me a sefer de'im. And not only that, you want this far to call them a bunch of frogs? Sherabbanan lam nush sefaradim nekrim lishon sefer de'im. Verabbanay ham misad halag me keha sefer de'im ve imatobi ashar dawan. Is this nice? This is disgusting. This is not Borei Olam wants. But as if by any Elohim, by Adam, the Torah, the Kanot Shemra, al Ka'am al Kadosh Sefaradi Kullo, Bichlaluto, Mi Yuchal Et Apek al Bizayon ve Shemra al Kadosh Am al Kadosh. Where's the Tikkun Yoyil? Now, what kind of Tikkun are you going to do for yourself, you bunch of Hasidim? What Tikkun? Lechalot Ha'avon Hazze. What are you going to do to get rid of this Avon? Ul Hatem Ha'Pesha Hamur. אפילו המכנה שמרה לחברו If you say something bad, if you give a bad nickname to one person, what do the Hachamim say about you? They say you lose Olam Haba, right? That's your onish. Now you're talking about an entire nation. Take all the Sefer Adin. Imagine what's happening to you now. How many Hachamim are among this nation of Sefer Adin that you're referring to? Sorry, I'm a great, I'm into the Kabbalah myself. I studied, he was very baki in the Zohar, Meir Waqnin. I know of no tikkun for this. Yes, stop, buddy.
Even at John Shrove.
He's done. I know no tikkun. I cannot think of any sort of fix for you guys. Now, saying now, if your great rabbi, your Munkacher Rebbe, Rabbi Shapira, actually wrote this stuff and he said this stuff, he's going to have a hard time. He's going to have to go start jumping mountains, and rolling in the valleys, and maybe Hashem will find a way, to bring peace among Am Yisrael. And he left it at this, but he wasn't happy with just sending this letter out as is. Okay, this was 1931. The book came out 30. He wrote this in 31. He didn't want to send it by itself. He sent his letter to Rabbi Yaakov Haizirihan, who was the chief rabbi of Tebaria. Okay,
before him.
Okay, so Rabbi Zirihan was chief rabbi until 53. From 53 on, Rabbi Meir Waqnin took over. So at this point, Rabbi Zirihan is still chief rabbi. He sent this to Rabbi Zirihan. Zirihan went more ballistic, but we don't have time to read it. But you got the basic idea. And Goldman has a very weak answer on page 12. We'll leave it at this for now. Next week is Ta'anit, so no class. Maybe we'll do it the week after. We'll be in touch. You all game?
Yeah.
Good?
Why don't we learn next week, though?
Because I can't scream like this and not drink coffee and not drink water. I can't do it. I'm being honest.
I thought that was your regular voice.